Well, you're all looking at me like it's time to start. Is that funny?
Thought we were going to get a tap.
No, and that's because it is time to start, right? I didn't realize that was so funny, but anyway, good morning and welcome, beloved of God. It's just good to be together. And you know, Lamentations 3 says, the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. It seems to me that whenever we open our eyes, if the Lord gives us a new day, He gives us a clean slate with new mercies. That's my interpretation, but I think it's, I like it. But His mercies never come to an end. And they never come to an end all day long, not just in the morning. So we'll begin this morning. We're finally in Revelation. Can you believe it? Not sure how long we're going to be there, but we're here in Revelation today in chapter 19. And I'm going to be reading verses 1 to 10 in chapter 19. Let's hear the word of the Lord to us this morning. After these things I heard, as it were, a loud voice of a great multitude in heaven saying, Hallelujah! Salvation and glory and power belong to our God, because His judgments are true and righteous. For He has judged the great harlot who was corrupting the earth with her immorality, and He has avenged the blood of His bondservants on her. And a second time they said, Hallelujah! Her smoke rises up forever and ever. And the 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and worshiped God, who sits on the throne, saying, Amen, Hallelujah! And a voice came from the throne saying, Give praise to our God, all you His bondservants, you who fear Him, the small and the great. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and as the sound of many waters, and as the sound of mighty peals of thunder, saying, Hallelujah, for the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and be glad and give the glory to Him, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and His bride has made herself ready. And it was given to her to clothe herself in fine linen, bright and clean. For the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. And he said to me, Write, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, These are true words of God. And I fell at his feet to worship him, and he said to me, Do not do that. I am a fellow servant of yours and your brethren who hold the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Amen. Please take your hymnals and turn to page 28. Look, ye saints, the sight is glorious, page 28. Okay, let's all stand as we sing this morning. Look, ye saints, the sight is glorious. See the Man of Sorrows now from the fight return victorious. Every knee to Him shall bow. Savior, angels crown Him, rich the trophies Jesus brings. In the seat of power enthrone Him, while the vault of heaven rings. Crown Him, crown. Projected on the screen. Come praise and glorify. Come praise and glorify our God the Father. He has in heavenly realms blessings. For pure and blameless in His sight, He destined us to be. Now we've been adopted through His Son. Praise of Your glory, to the praise of Your mercy and grace. Praise of Your glory, You are the God who saves. Had to keep one wrong fret. And glorify our God, gives His grace and grace. Our sins are washed away, redeemed His sacrifice. In Him God has known to us the mystery of His will, that Christ should be the head of all His purpose. Praise of Your glory, to the praise of Your mercy and grace. Praise of Your glory, You are the God who saves. Praise and glorify our God when we believe the word. And through our faith we have a seal, the Spirit of the Lord. The Spirit guarantees our hope until redemption's come. Until we join the endless praise, God the three. Of Your mercy and grace, praise of Your glory, You are the God who saves.
I want to welcome all of you. What a joy. Anybody here start their work day? If you work on the weekdays, you start at 8 o'clock in the morning. Anybody? 8 o'clock work days. Okay, we got a few. Anybody start at 7 o'clock? Okay, that's okay. More hands. Anybody start at 6 o'clock? Anybody 5:30? Okay. Anybody at 3:30, Steve? Okay. All right. Okay, now I got good news for you. We start on Sunday mornings at 9:30, okay? We actually have an hour that's available for folks, and I got to tell you, it is some of the funnest times. I'm with the younger kids, and there's a group that's with Steve Gressley doing the study on Christian armor, and then there's a group of ladies they're doing discipleship with Ashley, and we would love to expand that. And I love when this place is abuzz with discipleship. And some of you don't have the option of doing that, and I get that. And so we meet with some during the week for that purpose. But I got to tell you, I love to hear, like for example, just this moment ago, I enjoyed hearing the guitar. I love the guitar. Do you guys enjoy the guitar? Okay, all right. How about when the guitar is with the piano?
Yeah.
Is that not a great combination?
Sure.
Okay, all right. Now, you know what the best part of the worship, though, is? Is the sound of the saints joining in to sing the songs. Okay, guys, I got to tell you what a lovely sound. That has nothing to do with how well of a singer you are, okay? And I love to hear the sound of saints worshiping, reciprocating to God. Now, this morning, before we say our verse of the month, I'm going to have some kids come up and share with you what they've been learning on the subject of prayer. So you kids know who you are. Why don't you come on up? We've got a couple verses to share with you. No cheat sheets, okay? Kids, let's come on up. That'll be those in the first hour, kids, okay? Here we go. All right. All right. Come on up, Brady.
Your little brother right there.
Up in front. There you go, bud. John 14:6.
Whatever Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me.
Together. John 16:23.
Whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give it to you.
All right. 1 John 5:14.
If we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us.
And finally, 1 Thessalonians 5:17.
14.
Pray.
Pray without ceasing.
All right. Give them a round of applause. Good job, guys. Great job. They came up stage fright notwithstanding. So thank you. Thank you, guys. Our verse of the month, Matthew 11, 28 and 29. Let's say it together, shall we? Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest to your souls. I'm going to share with you a video as Jesse cues it up here. I'm going to just introduce this gentleman. Anybody here heard of Jordan Peterson? Okay. Anybody? Okay, got some hands. Okay, so you know where we're going with this. Now, this man is, I'm going to share, as Jesse gets it to the point there, we're going to share some of what he has said in his journey toward God. It's one of the most fascinating things I've ever heard, to hear a man who is originally a Darwinian, Freudian psychologist. He's a professor of psychology at a university in Toronto in Canada. And he's just been, he's just lost his job as a tenured professor because of his outspoken political incorrectness. But this is a man who, very liberal by origin, by background, but is coming towards God, and you're about to hear some segments of what it looks like for a person to come to repentance. Now, he doesn't speak for us in everything that he says. I want you to understand that. But he exhibits what repentance looks like. And so I want you to hear this and even pray for this man to come to Christ fully. Maybe you know someone that's in one of these stages of repentance, but you will watch this guy go from being an atheistic moralist to being a theistic moralist to then becoming a Christ-friendly man to becoming a Christ-terrified man, okay? And I want you to watch the progression. So Jesse's going to take us through a couple sound bites here.
Now, I'm saying that I don't go to church.
You guys all hear that in the back?
I don't go to church is because, while it drives me crazy, to speak frankly, I haven't been able to sit in a situation like that ever since I was, well, ever, really, absolutely truthful, ever. That's a good thing, because I do believe, and I've had good conversations about this with Jonathan Pageau, I do believe that communal return to the source of the community's ethics is actually a necessary thing. And maybe I'm atoning for my past sins by doing these biblical lectures at the moment, which is something that's communal. And then, because there's also something about going where a bunch of other people are to reaffirm your commitment to to the good that you're all aiming at. It's got some power in it, and I don't think that that's something that we should forego. I think it's dangerous. I mean, look, even if you're cynical about church, and I guess I would put myself in that category, it's certainly the case that communal church going in the 1950s, say, provided the average person with at least an hour a week where they were contemplating, no matter how poorly, the purpose of ethics in life and the idea of a higher purpose and a higher meaning in life. And you got to think that spending an hour a week thinking about that is better than never doing it at all. Mm. I don't know how that tradition can be revivified in a meaningful way, but I think I really do think it's a catastrophe that we've lost it, because we don't have a center, an ethical center that holds our community together, and the consequence of that is that we're fragmented right now. What you see there is that if you view someone with love, then it's incumbent upon you to treat them as if they're valuable. And then the more you treat other people as if they're valuable, the better person you are. That just comes along for the ride in some sense. So none of that seems questionable to me. That seems solid. And so then maybe the more love you view other people with, the higher the moral demand that's placed on you. And then I would say, too, well, then that's another reason why it's so important to be truthful and in some sense to be good, because it isn't obvious to me that you can withstand that moral load if you're compromised by too much sin. It's too much. And then that's another thing that we're not very good at teaching young people about. You know, we shouldn't do that. You know, it's like there's a sanctimonious authority that goes along with that, that's the wrong tone. It's more like, you know, I don't know how you lay it out properly, but you tell people that you love how to avoid the road to hell. And you don't do that because you're shaking your finger at them or because you're a moral authority. You do it because you don't want them to burn. And I think there's too much of the moral authority still in the church and not enough of the, you know, the love that helps people avoid the fire. Tammy, my wife, has always taken the idea of truth very seriously. Her recent brush with death has deepened her. The missing praxis in Western Christianity, if you want to be a Christian, let's say if you think that's necessary, it's not exactly obvious what you should do. You should go to church, but that's not enough, I don't think. I find it useful to contemplate the highest good on a continual basis. I'm trying to keep myself oriented in that direction. It's a religious orientation, fundamentally. It's an overwhelming orientation. But there's no escaping the questions of the ultimate meaning of life.
I'm not an atheist anymore, because I don't look at the world that way anymore. I'm not a materialist anymore. I don't think the world's made out of matter. I think it's made out of what matters. Mm. It's made out of meaning. What we orient towards unconsciously, which means what captures our attention, is meaning, and it captures our attention before we know what it is. The brain acts as if the world's made out of information or made out of meaning.
Who would have the audacity to claim that they believed in God if they examined the way they lived? Who would dare say that? To believe in a Christian sense, to actually, this is why Nietzsche said there was only ever one Christian, and that was Christ. To have the audacity to claim that means that you live it out fully. And that's an unbearable task in some sense. To be able to accept the structure of existence, the suffering that goes along with it, and the disappointment and the betrayal, and to nonetheless act properly, right? To aim at the good with all your heart, right? to dispense with the malevolence and your desire for destruction and revenge and all of that, and to face things courageously, to tell the truth, to speak the truth, and to act it out. That's what it means to believe. That's what it means. It doesn't mean to state it. It means to act it out. And unless you act it out, you should be very careful about claiming it. And so I've never been comfortable saying anything other than I try to act as if God exists. Because God only knows what you'd be if you truly believed. I mean, if you think about it in some sense, that's the central idea in Christianity, is that if you were capable of believing, it would be a transfiguring event, a truly transfiguring event. And I know people experience that to one degree or another, but we have no idea what the limit of that is, and we have no idea what the possibility is within each person if they live a life that was maximally courageous and maximally truthful. No, because maybe you're running at 60% or 70% or 20% at cross purposes to yourself. God only knows what you'd be if you believed. And so, while I try to act like I believe, but I'd never claim that I manage it. So you can think about Christ from a psychological perspective, and this particular critic that I've been reading. Well, that doesn't differentiate Christ much from a whole sequence of dying and resurrecting mythological gods. And of course, people have made that claim in comparative religion. Joseph Campbell did that, and Jung to a lesser degree, I would say, but Campbell did that. But the difference, and C.S. Lewis pointed this out as well, the difference between those mythological gods and Christ was that there's a representation of there's a historical representation of his existence as well. Now you can debate whether or not that's genuine. You can debate about whether or not he actually lived and whether there's credible objective evidence for that, but it doesn't matter in some sense because this, well, it does, but there's a sense in which it doesn't matter because there's still a historical story, and so what you have in the figure of Christ is an actual person who actually lived, plus a myth. And in some sense, Christ is the union of those two things. The problem is I probably believe that, but I don't know it. I'm amazed at my own belief, and I don't understand it. Because I've seen... Sometimes the objective world and the narrative world touch. You know, that's union synchronicity. And I've seen that many times in my own life. And so in some sense, I believe it's undeniable. You know, we have a narrative sense of the world. For me, that's been the world of morality. That's the world that tells us how to act. It's real. Like, we treat it like it's real. It's not the objective world. But the narrative and the objective world touch. And the ultimate example of that, in principle, is supposed to be Christ. But I don't know what to... that seems to be oddly plausible. But I still don't know what to make of it. It's too... At part because it's too terrifying a reality to fully believe. I don't even know what would happen to you if you fully believed it.
And that's where we're going to kind of cut it off. You can watch that online if you get around to it, but does that not break your heart? And thanks, Jesse, for your help on that, and let's get the lights. And I just want to call us to a repentance this morning. And maybe you're here today if you've not yet come to Christ, who says, come unto me. And here's a man who is probably on his way towards that. But I got to tell you, this is urgent. And so, Christian, if you're here today and you're, you know, dealing with sins and living a double life, let's repent of those things. And I want to, we had some discussion yesterday at our men's breakfast, and Bill Gressley was calling us to repentance. And this morning in Revelation, it will be calling us to repentance. And this man here, in the convictions of repentance, I mean, we really need this. This guy fears God more than most Christians do, I got to tell you. We need a little bit of holy terror of the Lord Jesus in order to appreciate his humility and lowliness. With that, I do want to mention one announcement is that there is a, you know what, I'm just going to ask Dorianne to explain it. Can you give her a mic, Jesse, so that we all hear? Can someone explain what it is in the back that we're trying to? Okay. Well, I've just learned of this. Okay, so there's a baby bottle in the back. It's to collect change for an ultrasound ministry for women in a pro-life effort here in that cause, and to provide assistance for that. So it's kind of a pro-life fundraiser of the local chapter of that. Okay. Okay, which is why I preferred that you be the one to say it in the first place. Okay, all right, okay. Well, I'd rather hear it from you. But that's by Jesse in the back there. Okay, tonight our prayer meeting will be at the Gressleys, just an FYI for those that attend prayer meeting. And I'm going to ask that Brother Cecil come up, and I want to praise the Lord that through many toils and snares, we've come here, right? But one of them has been the transmission of the Hines vehicle. The Lord is going to provide for that to be. I want to let you know, and this is the first time, Cecil, that you're hearing it. That between us and Salem Bible Church, we're gonna cover that expense of your transmission, so that you guys have a running vehicle again. And we appreciate all of you who have made the financial support possible for folks like the Hines and many others. But are you glad the Hines are with us? I really am already enjoying the benefits, but yes, right?
The prayer meeting, is it at 6 o'clock?
It's at 5:30.
Okay.
It's at 5:30.
Just for
tonight, yeah. Yeah.
And what's the address?
What I'll do is defer you to Kim and Steve. If you are planning to come, they will give you that address, okay? So you guys raise your hand so everybody knows who you are. Everybody knows who Kim and Steve are. Okay, there we go. Okay, so make sure that you get with them afterwards. I'm going to ask Brother Cecil to come up and lead us in a word of prayer, and then we'll turn it back over to you, Ray.
Thank you, Steve. Let's pray. Father, as I consider who you are, I wonder, as this Jordan Peterson has brought to my mind, how little I really understand the fear of God, how little I really grasp. Am I living this Christian life that you have made possible through the death, the burial, the resurrection of your Son Jesus Christ, the God-man who had to hang on a cross, who was innocent of sin and carried all of my wickedness, all of the world's wickedness on that cross, nailed it there, was put in a grave alone and resurrected the third day. And because of that, I can have eternal life. I don't deserve it, and yet you, by your grace and mercy, have provided it for me and for all of us who come believing in that. And Father, I pray for that soul that's here today that has not accepted that free gift of salvation that cost your Son everything and is provided for us absolutely free by believing in the Lord Jesus Christ, his person, his death, his burial, his And Father, may each of us sitting here who know you as Savior, may we continue to meditate upon your word and to meditate upon just the thoughts this morning. Do we live like we believe it? Or are we in action and in application an atheist? We can be, Lord. We can be. And may we not be. Father, again, I thank you for this time. I thank you for the good worship time we've had so far in the first hour, as well as what we have already experienced here, and the singing and the music and the fellowship. And Father, may this not be something that we only experience an hour or two once or twice a week, but may it be something that we experience many times throughout the week as we sing those spiritual songs and those hymns to ourselves and as we spend time alone in the Word with you. Father, again, I thank you for this time. I thank you for Steve as he's preaching. I thank you for the message that he has provided and as you have prepared him for and prepared in him for us. I pray that each of us would listen, we would learn, and then we would go forth and live in the fear of a holy, sovereign God. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Okay, once again, please take your hymnals and turn to page 160 for our hymn of the month, My Jesus, I Love Thee, page 160. Projected on the screen, and this is a new one. We did it in class on Thursday, and I hope I know it a little bit better today than I did Thursday, but it's a good one. Almost Home. Almost gone.
understand. And not a tear shall fall and almost home. Make ready now your souls for the kingdom come. Turning back, we're almost home. Almost home, we're almost home. So press on toward the blessed shore. Praise the Lord, we're almost home. That great forever, almost home. What song and who will sing round that happy throne? Beat of heart, we're almost home. Almost home, we're almost home. So press on toward that blessed shore. Oh, praise the Lord, we're almost home. Just the vapor, we're almost home. The sun is set in yonder, almost home. Take courage for this darkness shall break through dawn. Oh, lift your eyes, we're almost home. Almost home, we're almost home. So press on toward that blessed shore. Oh, praise the Lord, we're almost home.
Well, I invite you to take up your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Revelation as we conclude and begin to conclude our Bible survey that has gone on for 2.5, maybe longer years. Ray seemed skeptical as to whether we would be finishing anytime soon. So we walk by faith, though, Ray. You know,
maybe we spend the rest of the year in Revelation.
Rest of the year? Well, yeah, that's not going to happen. But however, this is the climax. I mean, it is the climax of all that we believe. And I am so thrilled to look at this in kind of from a bird's eye view, from a helicopter, from a 30,000 foot view. We took about 5 years ago. We did a 3-year study from more of a worm's eye view, verse by verse. But this is a bird's eye view, and it's valuable to take that perspective on the Word of God. In fact, from the Scriptures, we've seen from Genesis to Revelation how the theme of Scriptures is what, guys? Who? Anybody? There it is, Jesus Christ. And Revelation really ends on a strong note of giving us a vision of Him. Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. And if you're looking for a fresh vision of Christ, go no further than the book of Revelation. In all the Scriptures, they speak concerning Himself, but Revelation really is the capstone and really ends on a note of ultimacy. He is the ultimate one. You know what's interesting about the Bible is you see different leaders and heroes throughout the Scriptures, but you see them with their warts and all. You see them with their blemishes, and they disappoint almost without exception. Book of Judges is famous for that, right? You've got that antithetical demonstration of what the true Savior of men ought to be. But then there's these judges who fall short. They do good things, but they fall short. They stumble and they fall short. And then comes Jesus, the ultimate judge and savior of all the earth, the king and the king of all the earth. And so in Revelation, we approach this book with great awe and reverence. The theme of the book, as I've put on the screen there, is the unveiling of Jesus Christ. The unveiling of Jesus Christ, which is where what is the word revelation itself mean? It comes from the Greek word apokalypsis, from which we get the English word apocalypse, which means an unveiling. It literally means a disclosure of that which was previously hidden or unknown. but it's very specific as to what is being disclosed when you look at Revelation chapter 1, verse 1. Very important, that verse. It says, "The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John." Who is it the revelation of, guys? Jesus Christ. It's the revelation of Jesus Christ. And so the unveiling of Jesus Christ, the theme of the book, and to really drive that point home, our key verse, I've got it on the screen, and I really meant to say Revelation 1, 17 and 18. Let's go ahead and say that together. In these verses is contained all the basic themes of the book. It says, "When I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead, and he laid his right hand upon me, saying unto me, Fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead. Behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and of death." There's a number of candidates of verses that we could have chosen there, but you got to think about the author of the book here and what was going through his mind as he wrote about the revelation of Christ. There's a beautiful symmetry to this book because it begins and ends with an awesome vision of the Lord. Revelation 1 contains the Patmos vision. Revelation 19, the second coming. Two incredible visions of the Lord really sandwich the book. And we have that Patmos vision, which we'll look at in a moment, but that unveiling of Christ in both cases sets the tone for the entire book. And this author is stuck in isolation and in exile on the island of Patmos, which was a prison colony island in the Mediterranean. And this is a desperate place for John to be. Now, church history tells us, or tradition tells us, that they had attempted to martyr him by putting him in boiling oil, but he survived, so they exiled him here. So he's here on the heels of great suffering. Consider John for a moment as he's in this desolate place. He's in a very isolated place. And there were other people, prisoners, it was a labor camp, essentially. So by exile, we do not mean completely alone. But he's there, and in that desperate place, God chooses to give him one of the most comforting visions ever given to the church. In this book of Revelation, we have it in chapter 1, verse 9. "I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ." The context is one of suffering. Okay? John is very similar to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the sense that it was in that context of suffering that the fourth man appears. That's when the fourth man always appears, in the context of God's people suffering for his name's sake. God shows up in those moments like never before. Paul speaks of it in Philippians when he spoke of the fellowship of his suffering, right? And John experiences the fellowship of Jesus like never before in a place that is very low and desperate. We are at the end of the first of the apostolic age. John is the last of the dirty dozen, the original dirty dozen, as some have said. He's the surviving apostle. He will die of natural causes, but it wasn't without great suffering that he reaches this point to be able to share with us the revelation of Jesus Christ. Remember that John is something of an archetype of all of the saints, when we consider that they were strangers and pilgrims in the earth. And they look at him here, if you will, and I consider John in a very ugly place, right? Well, unless he had a view of the Mediterranean, but it's a very dry and rocky landscape, and yet his eyes are gazing on a distant world, on a future city, and a city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. That's the kind of people that Christians are, is that they don't belong here, and no matter how hard they try, they're not going to fit in, and the world is not going to love you. No matter how much you give it, it will not love you back. It certainly never died for you. You don't owe the world anything. this world crucified our Lord. We will never fit in here. We are in the world, but not of the world, John wrote when he quoted the high priestly prayer in John 17, remember? John, living that out now, is looking towards a future world in which Christ reigns supreme, visibly, and established in the sight of all. So this is written by a man, as the book of Hebrews says, the world is not worthy. I've shared some of them with you. That guy in Korea last week, I shared with you. A guy in China the week before. These are people of whom the world is not worthy. They did not fit in. And if you're struggling with worldliness today, if you feel that draw of the world pulling you into its system, then this book is designed to cure us of worldliness, I will tell you, okay? Because you can't look and take seriously the words of this book and still long for the things of this world. So we're going to consider that this morning. Why should we study the book of Revelation? I'm going to give you several reasons, and I've tried to outline them here. Why should we study the book of Revelation? It isn't just in order to figure out who the Antichrist is, okay, guys? It isn't just so you have your eschatology math all lined up and your ducks in a row with eschatology. I'm going to give you what I believe are seven great reasons to study the book. And the first I'm reminded of when I consider what my son Tim used to say when we were on long trips, okay? Tim used to say, "It's a long trip, Dad." When are we going to get there, is in other words, okay? Now, did you know that the saints have been saying something like that regarding our pilgrimage since day one, okay? Let me give you some examples. In Psalm 42, after he says, "My heart pants as the deer pants for the water brook, so my heart pants after you," and he goes on to say, "When shall I appear before God?" When, right? It's a long trip. or Isaiah 64, Isaiah appealing to God, almost desiring the same thing that John did at the end of Revelation. He says, "Oh, that you would just rip the heavens open and come down like lava on the mountain." Let's get it on already. And do you feel that? Can you relate? Can you join in solidarity with the saints as they're like, "I would love to see this thing get resolved"? Enough with the apparent anarchy of geopolitics in this world, which are an utter mess and a depraved cesspool. I'm ready for a new administration. And if you're saved, you cannot help but identify with people who say that, like John, "Oh Lord Jesus, come quickly." Or how about in Acts, when Peter, I think it was, asked, "Will you at this time establish the kingdom?" Remember that? In other words, are we there yet? And Jesus' answer at the time was, "It's not for you to know the times and the seasons which the Father has placed within his hands." In other words, not yet, but in the future. Not now, and not yet. Well, Revelation, thankfully, doesn't leave us like spiritual moles or eyeless fish in the bottom of Mammoth Cave, right? The eyeless fish. You know, Christians get to have a glimpse of the future so that they can make sense of geopolitics in the world around us. Well, we don't have to be unnerved and unsettled by the fact that Russia's troops are amassing at the border of the Ukraine. You know, we don't have to be unsettled by the fact that the Israelis are getting ready for an attack on the nuclear arsenal of Iran. We don't have to be unsettled by the fact that America has lost really its first world status in this planet. You know, we don't have to be unnerved by these massive and seismic shifts on the planet in our lifetime. In fact, we should be much encouraged in view of what's coming very quickly. Look at chapter 1, verse 1. It says, "The things which must shortly come to pass." First reason to study the book is because it consummates history. Book of Revelation is not like rock music, which has no harmonic resolution, okay? It doesn't naturally resolve itself. That's the thing about rock music. History, on the other hand, has resolution. It's not dystopian. You understand? And God, being the author of history, and Christ, by whom he created the ages, brings things to a resolution, ties up loose ends. No waste will there be in God's program. Everything that happened along the way, all seeming catastrophes, he will work for good and his ultimate glory. All loose ends tied up in the book of Revelation. We have God resolving history on not a minor key, okay, but a major key for you for the musicians in the room, okay? Okay, I didn't mix the metaphors. But it is a long trip, okay? It consummates history. It comes with a blessing. Chapter 1, verse 3 says, "Blessed is he that readeth, that heareth, and that keepeth the words of this book." There's a blessing for those who take it literally. Now, there is symbolism in this book, but it is to be taken as a narrative book in the sense that there is broken chronology throughout the book, and I'll explain that. There is symbolism, and when it is a symbol, it will say so. It'll make that clear. It expects the student of Scripture to have read from Genesis up to this point, okay? And if you've done that, then you're going to know what is meant by the serpent, and you're going to know, you know, what is meant by, you know, other symbols in the book. And so that's going to inform a lot of that symbolism. However, it comes with a blessing for those who take literally, for example, that Christ's coming will be in advance of his 1,000-year reign, as it makes abundantly clear in chapter 19. You know, there is a blessing for those who believe in the literal return of our Lord, which there are different forms, systems of eschatology out there, but every true Christian believes in a literal return of the Lord Jesus. Did you know that's a basic tenet of the faith? Right up there with his bodily resurrection, his death and bodily resurrection, and his virgin birth. It's right up there with that. It's that important to believe in the bodily return and physical return of Jesus Christ to consummate his kingdom. And that's a basic tenet of the faith. That's a non-negotiable, okay? Now, I'm a premillennial believer, and I know other believers who are not, but they all believe in the literal physical return of Jesus Christ, whom we will see face to face. Whom my eyes shall see, as Job said, and not another, my Redeemer liveth and shall stand in the latter day upon the earth, right? Basic tenet of all the saints, going back all the way to Enoch, right? As we saw in the book of Jude. The Lord cometh with 10,000 of his saints. So guys, it comes with a blessing for those who believe it. Thirdly, it concludes the canon. If you check out chapter 22, verse 18, you know this if you've been with us for our study of bibliology, or the idea that the Bible, all 66 books, are inspired and sufficient. There is no sequel. There is no supplement. There is no current direct revelation coming from the Lord. No, this concludes the New Testament revelation from God. And so we go back to the book. We're people of the book. One reason for that is that Revelation 22:18 says that I testify to every man that hears the words of the prophecy of this book. If any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in the book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part from the tree of life and out of the holy city from the things that are written in this. But that's a pretty harsh curse on those who add or take away. Anybody comes into this church and says, I have a direct word from the Lord, deny him the ability to propagate his error. Because the scripture is very clear that it's closed with the book of Revelation. Thus saith the Lord, we go back to the scriptures. If any man speak according to this word, there is no light in him. Make sure, Paul says, that thou go not beyond what is written in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And what goes beyond what is written is when you go beyond the book of Revelation. So it concludes the canon of scripture. Very clearly there's a seal. And, you know, very scary to break that seal. The book of Revelation converges on Scripture's theme. And we heard it in our Scripture reading where it says that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Now, you've probably all met, or maybe you've even gotten into the minutiae of prophecy. and you've gotten really preoccupied with the identification of the Antichrist and all of these things. But I got to tell you, if we're not focused on Christ when we study prophecy, then we're missing the point of prophecy. He is the point of the gospel. He is the point of prophecy. He is the point of the Psalms. Guys, let's not get off center as we study Revelation, because it converges on the theme of Scripture. It is consistent with Scripture. Don't want to be one of these people that are interested in Revelation but not interested in the rest of the canon, because it stands and falls with it. My vision. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, right? Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. This book converges on Scripture's theme. And then, additionally, this book counts on Christ's return. The book ends in chapter 22 and verse 20. Take a look at it. Chapter 22, verse 20, surely he who testifieth these things saith, surely I come quickly. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. The Scripture counts on Christ's return. You know, the saints count on Christ's return. We love his appearing because we count on Christ's return. You remember in the false religion of deism, it believes in the existence of God, but denies that God is interested any longer in his creation. Well, the idea of a second coming and of the literal return of Christ makes that impossible. God has not abandoned his creation to a future of uncertainty. In fact, I want to share a little quote from one of my favorite books, Greatness of the Kingdom by Alpha J. McLean. And here's what he says on the subject of deism, the idea that God has abandoned us long ago. It is not such a consummation of history a necessary postulate of our thoughts? Would we not expect such a transition period between the present and the ultimate everlasting condition? As we have seen in the past, a succession of developments of which man is the highest, is there not to be the reign of the Son of Man and a sphere in accordance with his character and glory? Is there to be always the contrast between heaven and earth, the ideal and the actual? Is the history of the world, which began with miracle and a period of constant manifestation of the higher world unto the children of men, is it not to terminate in a similar age of heavenly influence and blessedness? Is earth simply a failure abandoned by God to the power of the enemy, the scene of divine judgment and not the scene of the vindication of triumph and righteousness? Is not Jesus the Son of Man, the Christ who shall reign on the earth? We believe that he will come, and with him the kingdom, and with the kingdom the fulfillment of the prayer, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Okay, that's just one reason why you should pick up a copy of the book, Greatness of the Kingdom. But guys, you know, this idea of God abandoning us, not the case if you believe in the second coming of Christ. The Scripture counts on Christ's return. And next, the Scripture, the book of Revelation, confirms God's sovereignty. And in our key verse, we learn that when he says, "Fear not, I am he that liveth and was dead. Behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys." So constantly throughout the book, we're changing scenes from earth to heaven and back to earth and then back to heaven again, just to remind you that he's still on the throne. He hasn't left the throne. The throne is occupied. There's not this anarchical universe. We live in a universe, not a pluriverse, remember, in which there's one God and he reigns. He's always been reigning. The throne has never been vacant. It's just that now it becomes very apparent who is on that throne as the end approaches. Okay? So when we say, "Thy kingdom come," it's not that we don't believe he's ruling. It's that we are praying for that to become visible and enforced on planet Earth. Okay? We count on Christ's return. This book confirms God's sovereignty and shows us that higher throne which is occupied by none other than the Lamb who was slain. But finally, it calls the sinner to the Savior. And we see this in the very last appeal made in chapter 22. Let him that is athirst come. Whosoever heareth, let him come. And the appeal of the evangelist is the one of the last notes given in the Bible is God's evangelistic heart is laid bare as he appeals to the sinner in what is still an age of grace. Don't you find that interesting? At the heels of all that judgment, God will make one last appeal in his word to the sinner. Will you not come? Will you not take advantage of this limited, this time-limited opportunity? What are you waiting for? Here stands the nail-pierced Christ with hands outstretched at the end of the book to invite sinners to himself. It's awesome when you consider how great he is and yet how patient and how willing to receive you to himself. If you've not done that today, then the book of Revelation gives one last appeal for you to do so before the shock and awe campaign of Christ begins with the seal and the trumpet and the bowl of judgments that's going to be unleashed upon this world. Imagine if you were an inhabitant of Baghdad back in, 2003, was it, when the U.S. forces invaded Baghdad. What if you were an inhabitant of that place and you weren't just looking at it from the night vision screen that was on the news? Do you remember the night vision screen and the unlimited number of bombs that were going off at that time? I cannot imagine if I was on the ground in that moment. The likelihood of surviving that, very minimal, okay? That's called a shock and awe campaign. Folks, that is coming to this world on a much grander scale. I don't want to be here when it happens. There's an opportunity for you to come to the open arms, outstretched arms of a crucified Savior who loves you, but will judge those who reject him. So folks, we enter the book on that note. I want to share with you just an outline. It's always a little scary when I'm halfway through my time slot and I'm only getting out of the introduction. But, and before we get to this, I'm going to just introduce and then we'll pray. Do you guys remember what happened when the Syrian army had surrounded the city where Elisha was staying? And here's what Elisha prayed, because Gehazi gets up in the morning and he's freaking out because they're surrounded. And Gehazi is losing it. And Elisha prays. He says, "O Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes that he may see." And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw. And behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elisha. Now, John has caught a vision of Jesus Christ. He wants us to catch a vision of Christ as well. He spends this book trying to impress us with Jesus Christ. But if you'll have eyes to see, if God could open the eyes of our heart, it is my prayer today for us that God would open the eyes of our hearts so that we could be so conscious of spiritual realities that we can't go back to normal, okay? In fact, if our eyes could be opened even at this moment, I am sure that there's a cloud of demonic activity surrounding this room right now, matched with another cloud of angelic activity and the very presence of Jesus Christ as he walks through this room. At least that's how he's described in Revelation chapter 1, walking among the golden candlesticks, which are descriptions of the churches, the local assemblies. He's here. The angels are here. The demons are there. And this world is not the only thing that there is, guys. There is heaven and there is hell. And if our eyes could just be opened to these realities, our lives would change. Let me share with you this prayer as we go to the Lord. And I quote from A.W. Tozer's Pursuing God, Pursuit of God here. But let's pray this together. Please. O God and Father, I repent of my sinful preoccupation with visible things. The world has been too much with me. Thou hast been here and I knew it not. I have been blind to thy presence. open my eyes that I may behold thee in and around me. O God, quicken to life every power within me that I may lay hold on eternal things. Open my eyes that I may see. Give me acute spiritual perception. Enable me to taste and know that thou art good. Make heaven more real to me than any earthly thing has ever been. Amen. Let's talk about the majesty of Jesus Christ. We are going to kind of bypass the outline of the book, but I'll just say this because we don't have time to get into the details today. We'll leave some of those for next time. This is one of the few books in the Bible that gives its own outline at the beginning. In Revelation chapter 1:19, Jesus says to John, write the things which A, thou hast seen, B, the things that are, and C, the things that shall be hereafter. And that really is the outline of the book. In chapters 1 are the things which he has seen, namely the Patmos vision. Chapters 2 and 3, the things which are, the letters to the churches in what is largely the church age. And in chapters 4 to 22, in the bulk of the book, eschatology and prophetic events, including the most of which will be the tribulation period. We'll get into the details next time, but I wanted to leave you with this book is well laid out. It's similar to the book of Acts, where it gives an outline at the beginning. Jesus said, you shall be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the world. And then if you go through Acts, he literally follows that progression. That's the outline of the book. Does that make sense? And so we enter this book with an understanding of its structure. But let's go into the major motifs as we consider. Now, I will argue that each of these motifs that I've laid out here in an acronym, which we're not going to get through today, okay? Let me relieve you. Okay. Each of these motifs is a motif that has recurred throughout Scripture. Okay? Remember what I said about the book of Revelation tying up loose ends? It's going to bring back to our memory things we've been learning about since Genesis, Job, Psalms, okay? Things are going to be brought forward, and we'll be forced not to forget the other part of Scripture. So that's one of the benefits of the book of Revelation. It is designed to be a bookend to Scripture. We begin with the appropriate place to begin, which is the royal majesty of Christ. We're only going to take four today. Royal majesty of Christ, and we'll spend most of our time on that. Now, as I mentioned, the Patmos vision is meant to be something of a tone setter for the book. Do you remember a similar book in the Bible where there was a vision of God that was meant to set the tone for the entire book? Anybody? Not a rhetorical question. Isaiah. Isaiah 6, he catches a vision of the Lord high and lifted up, and he can't let go of that vision, and he doesn't want the people of Israel to ever forget just how great God is. He spends the rest of his entire ministry trying to get others to see the vision of Jesus Christ that he saw, to explain in great, high theological language just how great he and his servant is. And very similarly, John is captured by this vision of Jesus on the Isle of Patmos. He's transfigured, so to speak. What does he see? In chapter 1, he sees a man whose eyes are like a flame of fire. His eyes are ablaze. What does that tell you? He can see right through me. I mean, this is the God of 1 Samuel, where it says that he says, God looketh not, the Lord looketh not on the outward appearance, but on the what? On the heart. He sees right through me. I am naked and open before him with whom I have to do. He can properly assess me like no other. I am naked and open before him as his eyes, his omniscient and holy eyes are flame of fire. I see a robe down to his feet. John sees this robed figure whose eyes are ablaze. The robe down to the feet speaks of his royalty, his kingly garb. This is not a mere priest here, but a king. Someone who is now acting in a kingly capacity. Even as we speak, he is a king and the King of Kings. So he is clothed with a royal robe. He puts out a majestic appearance that John saw a part of back on the Mount of Transfiguration. And yet here he is laying at his feet as dead. This must have eclipsed even what he saw in the Mount of Transfiguration, because here he lays at his feet as dead. This is the effect that a holy God has on sinful men. This is what he did to Job when he showed up in a whirlwind. God has this effect on sinners. And someday we're going to be without sin. Yeah, everybody says, well, I read the book, Jesus wins. Do you understand what it means that Jesus wins? It means I will be sinless one day and capable of standing erect in the presence of Jesus without losing all muscular function. That day is coming in which I can converse with the Lord in a holy state of glorification. But John is not at that state yet. He falls at his feet as dead. Jesus, however, matches his fear by saying, "Fear not." Now, why should I not be afraid in the presence of a holy and awesome judge like Jesus Christ? There's only one reason. It's because you've been saved by him. You know, it says in Psalms, the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and are safe. You know, the very strength and majesty of the Lord that judges sinners also protects and safeguards the saints. It is that very majesty that preserves me from falling, which is what condemns others to hell who reject him. You see, what do you do with the majestic person of Christ? You flee to him. 1 Thessalonians 1:10 says that we wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. And that's why he says, "I am he that liveth and was dead, and I'm alive." He references back to his death. John, because of me, the wrath of God towards you has been disarmed on my back. Right? By referring to his death, he refers back to the finished work of the cross by which Jesus is now safe to be in the presence of because I've been saved by him. God's wrath is disarmed because of him towards those who flee for refuge. Have you fled for refuge to Jesus Christ? If so, then his word to you is fear not, fear not. So the timing of this is very important. He's about to unload a series of judgments on this earth. And before he does, he wants us to have a view of the person who is on the throne and who reigns. He wants us to be so captured by that that we're not unsettled by the other. When he shakes the heaven and the earth, he wants us to have a vision of him who changes not. Think of it like this. If you had a war zone and you have a refugee family where the father is taking a little girl in his arms, his daughter, let's say, and he says, "Don't take your eyes off me." They're about to walk through a field of bloody bodies and blown up bodies in a war zone. He says, "Just don't take your eyes off me," the whole time as he takes his daughter through, or his child, through the war zone. And it's almost like Jesus is doing that at the book outset to John. He's like, "Don't take your eyes off me," the whole time. "You keep your eyes on me, you'll be fine. I'll get you through this." Why? He holds the keys. He's got all the authority of death and of Hades. "Your eternal destiny hinges on me, and you're right with me." Listen, what does it mean that he holds the keys? It means that your eternal destiny depends on him. He's the one that'll let you into heaven or the one that will cast you into hell. Okay? "No man cometh to the Father but by," I hold the keys. Do you see that impenetrable barrier? God's presence is impenetrable to those who do not know Christ, but to those who know him, they've come to the Father by him. He's the one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. And so he holds the keys. There's no getting to God but by him. Okay, but if you've come to him, then you've come to God. So keep him in your view. He's called something in the book of Revelation, and that is the Alpha and Omega. The Alpha and Omega is a title given to him at the beginning of the book and illustrate in chapter 1, verse 8. "I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, saith the Lord, who is and who was and who is to come." Now that is quoted four times. It's in chapter 1, verses 8 and 11, and in chapter 21, verses 6 and 22 and verse 3. Four times, two at the beginning, two at the end. Revelation is a very symmetrical book. Why would he want us to know that he is the beginning and the end? It is as if to say He exists consistently outside of time, and throughout all the ages, he remains constant. It is as if to say what he said in Matthew 28, "Lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age," right? It is as if to reconfirm what God said in Isaiah 57, "Thus saith the high and lofty one who inhabiteth eternity," right? It is as if to repeat what was said in Hebrews 12:2, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. I'm the Alpha and Omega. It's not over till I say it's over. And I'm showing up to end it. All right? This book begins and ends with this title. And so what a beautiful picture of his sovereignty in this title. He's called the Alpha and Omega, the Lord of history, if you will. He's called the ruler of the kings of the earth in chapter 1, verse 5. He's called the Lamb who was slain in chapter 5. And the historic hero of our redemption is, and the captain of our salvation is worshipped there. He's called the faithful and true in chapter 3, in chapter 19, and in chapter 22. What's that mean, faithful and true? It means someone, think of him as a 4-star or a 5-star general who wears the stripes of his accomplishment wherever he goes. He is tried and proven. His qualifications and battle scars are legendary. Wherever he goes, his reputation precedes him. This is a man, this is a battle-tested captain. This is a savior and a king. This is a person who's been through hell and back again. This is a person who has demonstrated his reliability under fire. This is a person of tested character. Faithful and true. That's what's written on his thigh as he comes back in chapter 19 in with the clouds of heaven. Someone that can be trusted. He's called the King of Kings and Lord of Lords in chapter 19. He's called the root and offspring of Jesse in chapter 22, reminding us that he is both the ancestor and the successor of Jesse. How can you be both someone's ancestor and their successor? How does that work? Only if you're the God-man. The Lord said unto my Lord, "Sit thou at my right hand until your enemies become your footstool." So guys, we're talking about the most unique and qualified person in the universe to pull this off. He is qualified and he's trustworthy. I want to read something to you also from Greatness of the Kingdom. On this title, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, you ever thought about what that means? It means he's sovereign. He outranks every ruler in this world. A description of the coming king would describe, for the most part, the kingdom itself, which couldn't be if the kingdom was just a collection of human attempts at social and political improvement. Because this will be a mediatorial government, there must be a personal ruler, not just an organization to stand between man and God. What the world needs isn't a more perfect system of legislation, but a person with the wisdom and power needed to rule for God among men. That person is the central theme of prophecy because he is the center of the prophesied kingdom. The restoration of man's lost dominion must come through a man, the king, to whom the judgments of God are committed. God's government must rest upon his shoulder. The messianic ruler cannot be reduced to a mere nation or movement or ideal. Not only is he an ideal person, he is a real person. Praise God for that. He's the Son of Man. He's the ideal man. He's the person we could never be. He's the person we could never find among the sons of men to vote for in a democratic election. No. He's not going to join that. He's the ideal man, and he's a real person. Okay, that's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That's the majesty that we're introduced to in his second coming in chapter 19. I'll just give you an introduction to his second coming because I like skipping to the end of books, okay? And I'm skipping past the tribulation. Forgive me for that. In chapter 19, verse 11, "I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew that but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies that are in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, and with it he should smite the nations and rule them with a rod of iron. He treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he has in his vesture and his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He says, behold, in verse 11, behold, in other words, see for your benefit. This climactic entry, and Jesus knows how to make an entry, okay? And John says in chapter 19, I saw this happen. John the seer is seeing something that is as good as done. He speaks of it in the past tense, that which has not yet occurred. Why would he speak that way? Because it is so certain. It's what's called proleptic speech in prophecy. They speak of that which is future as if it's already done. It is so certain. And so certain is the coming of Jesus that it says, the day of the Lord shall come in 1 Peter, 2 Peter. I listened to some skeptics the other day on YouTube. I was listening to a video in which they were mocking the idea of the return of Jesus Christ, saying, do you believe that there are people in this population who actually believe in the second coming of Jesus? And they were mocking, just mocking. And to that, John says, I saw this happen. It's that certain. I saw this happen. So behold it for your benefit. He's riding a white horse. What's with the white horse? Okay, this is rooted in historical imagery here. In a Roman triumphal procession, a general would return from a successful campaign that he and his legions were on, and they would parade up the Via Sacra in Rome, the main street, and the general would be mounted on a white horse. The general rides at the head of his troops. They're all on horses, but he's at the head, followed by wagon loads of booty that was taken and captives in chains. Reminds you a little bit of Isaiah 53, verse 12, where it says, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hands. Reminds you of Hebrews 12, 2, where it says, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame. You talk about an ultimate vindication, ultimate poetic justice. Here he comes. This has been a long time coming. It is about time for a victory lap. And he rides a white horse. He wears a vesture dipped in blood. This vesture is that of a king, but it is spattered with blood. And it's not the blood of atonement that was once shed. And the day of grace is now past, but rather it is the blood of vengeance upon his enemies. Do you understand the seismic shift that has happened away from the age of grace that we're in right now to a day of the Lord in which he executes judgment? Folks, I want to just bring us to conclusion this morning, bring our thoughts together and really focus on this Lamb of God. There's an amazing tension in the person of Christ when you look at him in the scripture. Be sure not to oversimplify Jesus in your mind, because he's both a lion and a lamb. Right? How many times is he referred to in the book of Revelation as the Lamb? Worthy is the Lamb. The wrath of the Lamb. There's an oxymoron for you. Wrath of a Lamb. I've never heard of an angry Lamb. And yet the wrath of the Lamb. These people on earth are saying, hide us from the wrath of the Lamb. What's going on? Well, he's also the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Here is a complex and unique person, this person of Christ. The same hands that were scarred for our sins will cast people into eternal separation from God. Now, this Jesus, let's not oversimplify him and reduce him into a politically correct box here, folks. Look at the vindication of the Lamb. It's another of the motifs, the vindication of God here. And you remember that statement made by Julius Caesar, I think it was, Vini, Vidi, Vici. I came, I saw, I conquered. Only in this case, I came, I saw, God conquered. And here he shows up. By the way, this victory is the follow-through of his original victory over the devil at the cross, in which he crushed the serpent's head. He dealt him a fatal blow at the cross, and he's now following through on that original victory. Now think about the cross for a moment. Who fought that battle? Was anyone participating with Jesus in that battle, or was he all by himself? He was all by himself. It says in Isaiah 53, "Surely he hath borne our sins." All by himself. In complete isolation, Jesus gained victory single-handedly over sin and death and the devil. And who's fighting this battle in Revelation 19? Well, the sword is no longer at his thigh where you would expect the sword to be. It's drawn and it's proceeding from his mouth, the word of God. The sword is only held by Jesus. The saints behind him, these millions of saints that are his procession, these are just veterans of a war that they've already fought in. These are the saints. These are the church. These are the bride of Christ. And they're not there to fight. They're there to observe and be his entourage. And that's you and me if you've put your faith in Jesus. That's you and me who by that time will have been raptured and examined at the judgment seat of Christ. These saints that are clothed in white are not there to fight, but there to see their captain fight for them. Just as he alone bore our sins, he alone will execute judgment at Armageddon. Isn't that an interesting parallel? He's the hero. The cross was the D-Day, the invasion of the devil's kingdom that dealt him a death blow that would ultimately topple his kingdom. But this is V-Day. There was D-Day in World War II that was the beginning of the end of the Nazi regime. And then there was V-Day, which was the day when it was finally unconditional surrender and they turned over their forces and the Nuremberg trials began, right? You got D-Day and V-Day. First Advent, Second Advent. Here comes Jesus to conclude what he began. And he ties up his loose ends. He always finishes what he starts. He's the author and the finisher. I got to share something with you. What happens when one king invades another kingdom in classic warfare? Let me just share with you what happens. I'm reading a book right now, and I'm going to share a little passage from that here. What happens in classic warfare is illustrated by when Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, decided he was going to attack the northern kingdom of Israel. He sent this message to Ahab. Now, think about this for a second. He says, "Your silver and gold are mine. The best of your wives and children are mine." Now, the king of Israel, Ahab, answered, "Well, just as you say, my lord the king, I and all I have are yours." Now, that sounds absurd, doesn't it? But that was classic warfare. One king invades another kingdom, gains dominance over it, it's over. There's no protest, there's no anti-war protest, there's no Nuremberg, there's no none of this. "Just as you say, my lord the king, I and all I have are yours." When one king surrendered to another, he understood what it meant. I and all I have are yours. It should be unconditional surrender. You know, it's because Japan refused unconditional surrender that the atomic bomb was dropped. Jesus Christ, when he comes to this world, will accept nothing less than unconditional surrender. Do you see why the judgment will be so severe, the greatest that the world has ever seen, including World War II, okay? It'll be when Jesus comes. And this is how we need to react when we encounter Jesus Christ. Today, you've encountered Jesus Christ. I don't know how many times you've encountered him. But this is what Christian conversion should resemble. The person's kingdom has been overthrown by a new king. He doesn't come out to face the new master with a list of conditions. He's in trouble, and he knows it. The enormity of his sin overwhelms him. The magnitude of his crimes against God staggers him. As you heard Jordan Peterson. Did you catch that? The reality of his unworthy condition is too great to bear. The knowledge of his utterly lost condition terrifies him. He has nothing to offer God. He realizes there isn't a thing he can do to save himself. It is in this condition that he comes to the king and says, "I and all that I have are yours." And there, lying prostrate before God, he is hoping for one thing and one thing only, mercy. And my friend, if you do not bow the knee to him now, then you'll be crushed by him later. Now, this is the Jesus of the Bible who invites us to repent and says to the churches, repent and do the first thing, first works, or I will come unto you and take away your lampstand in chapters 2 and 3. Repent, for I have this against you. In chapter 3:19, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will open unto me, I will come in and I will fellowship with him. But there is an ultimatum surrounding Jesus Christ. To refuse him is to do so at your peril. You know how many times it says throughout the book of Revelation, they refuse to repent of their idolatrous deeds. Let me give it to you here. Neither repented they, in chapter 9, neither repented they of their murders, nor of their sorceries, nor of their fornication, nor of their thefts. Chapter 16, then men were scorched with great heat and blasphemed the name of God which hath power over these plagues, and they repented not to give him glory. Revelation 16, and blasphemed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores, and repented not of their deeds. Do you see a pattern here? It's a huge theme in Revelation. And so the book closes with this invitation in chapter 22, verse 17. The Spirit and the Bride say, come. Let him that heareth say, come. Let him that is athirst come. Whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. Sounds a little bit like our verse of the month, doesn't it? Come unto me. Are you a little shocked that a person of such majesty and glory is also described as lowly and humble? That's the thing about Jesus. You come unto him, he will accept you to himself. The concern today, brethren, is not whether you accept Jesus, but whether he has accepted you. Have you come to his open embrace by faith? Trust in his nail-scarred hands to save you from your sins. He's the only one who ever died for you. Will you trust him today? Or will you be like the people of judgment and refuse him? There's going to come a day when that refusal will be fixed in stone and you'll never be able to change back. Because in chapter 22, verse 11, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. He that is filthy, let him be filthy still. He that is righteous, let him be righteous still. He that is holy, let him be holy still. Behold, I come quickly. The day is coming when the choice, the opportunity for choice will be gone. Understand that that's what that's referring to in chapter 22. Your moral state will be fixed at a certain point in time and forever irrevocable. Permanently in a state of Christ rejection, or permanently in a state of bliss with Christ who has made me holy. That's an awesome thought. That's a terrifying thought for those who have not received him. Let me close in prayer. I thought it would be fitting to use another quote from A.W. Tozer. O Lord, I have heard a good word inviting me to look away to thee and be satisfied. My heart longs to respond, but sin has clouded my vision until I see thee but dimly. Be pleased to cleanse me in thine own precious blood and make me inwardly pure, so that I may with unveiled eyes gaze upon thee all the days of my earthly pilgrimage. Then shall I be prepared to behold thee in full splendor in the day when thou shalt appear to be glorified in thy saints and admired in all them that believe. Amen.
As you can see on the screen, we're closing with Just As I Am.
Just as I am. Shed for me. to be wounded. I come wounded to be healed. I come desperate to be rescued. I come empty to be filled. I come guilty to be pardoned by the blood of Christ the Lamb. And I'm welcome with open arms, praise God, just as I am. Just as I am, I could be lost, but mercy and grace, my freedom bought, and now to glory in your cross, O Lamb of God, I come. I come broken to be mended. I come wounded to be healed. I come desperate to be rescued. I come empty to be filled. I come guilty to be pardoned by the blood of Christ the Lamb. And I'm welcome with open arms, praise God, just as I am.
Close with this from Revelation chapter 1. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priest to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever. Amen.
Early, probably should be 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10 11 12 13 14 15 16 17 18 19 20 21 22 23 24 25 26 27 28 29 30 31 32 33 34 35 36 37 38 39 40 41 42 43 44 45 46 47 48 49 50 51 52 53 54 55 56 57 58 59 60 61 62 63 64 65 66 67 68 69 70 71 72 73 74 75 76 77 78 79 80 81 82 83 84 85 86 87 88 89 90 91 92 93 94 95 96 97 98 99 100 101 102 103 104 105 106 107 108 109 110 111 112 113 14 15 16 17 18 19 20 21 22 23 24 25 26 27 28 29 30 31 32 33 34 35 36 37 38 39 40 41 42 43 44 45 46 47 58 59 60 61 62 63 64 65 66 67 78 89 90 91 92 93 94 95 96 97 98 99 100 101 102 103